is something of relevance in equilibrium and non-equilibrium systems. It's a topic which I, which I did last year, collaboration with Schimansky-Geier, a student of his at Humboldt University. And it's a little bit outside from the mainstream of the research, of course, no one except me from the IFISC is involved in this. Are you laughing?
No. It's a technical problem.
Okay. But I think, what I want to tell you is a series of techniques. Some of them not so new, some of them new, which is my own work, about how to sample events with a low probability. Okay, that's a general issue. How to sample events which have a very, very low probability. And I will show you in the examples what I mean by low probability. Okay, that will be actually one of the key points of the talk. So this is a little bit summary of what I want to tell you. I will give you a brief review. Otherwise, the talk will be too short. Actually, it might not even end in 1 hour. In how to do that for Boltzmann distribution. Imagine you have a Boltzmann distribution and need to sample the tails of the distribution. So which are the techniques to do that? Some of them are well known. Then I will show you these new results of this weighted ensemble Brownian dynamic simulations. Then I will show you, give you the general ideas and then some applications, briefly the applications, very simple and stable system, recovering the Reynolds law, and this by stable potential. Then stochastic limit cycle. Then the bistable system with color noise, for which with the first two, you can compare with analytical results. Okay, here there is some theory which can serve to determine the validity of the method. And the last two, there is no exact theory. So what you can do here is to test with approximate theories or to obtain results directly from the numerical scheme, and then some conclusions. As I told you, this work has been done in collaboration with Schimansky-Geier at Humboldt University, and a student of his, Justus Kromer. I could not find a picture of Justus. This is all I found, okay? This is in his webpage. But he's very, but he's very tall. So like, large, to make it a scale, okay? To make it a scale. Okay, so which are the basic problems you encounter when you might, you want to sample a probability distribution, okay? One of the main problems, even if you know you have an expression for the PDF, for the probability distribution function, is that this distribution function might be peak around different values. And then the different maxima might be separated by regions of low probability. So reaching in the typical method in which what you do is to sample by local techniques, that means that you move around one point, it's very difficult from there to reach one of the other points, because the region connecting them have a very low probability. I'll give you some examples later. This happens, this is more, this is worse when the phase space has a large dimension. The phase space has a large dimension with n of the order of Avogadro number, ideally, of order of thousands or millions. This is even more acute. You have this very, very highly peak distribution separated by regions of almost nil probability, which is then it's very difficult to sample. In some of the cases, you might have one single maxima, but then the maxima is located somewhere. You don't know where it is. So it's a maxima which is located in a small fraction of pressure space. So you might start searching and searching and searching and never getting close to the area where the actual probability is taking place. So these are the two major sources of difficulties when sampling a PDF, even when you know the expression. For instance, you might have the well-known Boltzmann-Gibbs distribution, have the exponential minus beta, the Hamiltonian, beta 1 over kt, and see the partition function. Okay, so how do you proceed in this case? Which is the most widely used method is that of metropolis sampling. So what you do is to sample this by doing a random walk in phase space, and then visiting each point with a given probability. You do that in two times. First, you propose to go from one place to another, but then this proposal might or not be accepted. So H is the proposal probability, and G is acceptance. In most cases, this proposal is blind. So you simply move around in a blind fashion. So you go somewhere nearby with no preferred direction. So you use a uniform choice in the local neighborhood. Okay, most times you do that. But this is the typical scheme of a metropolis Monte Carlo. So you have a place space, you are in the point X, and you want to propose, you want to move to a region to, by repeating these movements, you want to ensemble the place space with the exact probability. So you do it in two ways. First, you propose, move from X to Y. Say, usually you do that blindly, uniformly, in a local region, and then you accept that with this probability, where delta H is the change of the energy that causes you to go from point X to point Y. By local, this local neighborhood, I mean really local, in the sense that if you have many variables, it is so local that you only change one of them. It is very difficult to make a proposal in which you change many variables at once and still the proposal to be accepted. So what you do is to change one variable and not too much. So you want the variables and change it by a small amount. Why is it so? Well, the reason is that you make a big jump, the most likely the chances are that the new energy will be much higher than the old one. So the acceptance probability will be small, will be exponentially small, with this minimum between 1 and e to the minus beta h. But you can very easily compute the average acceptance probability, and it happens to decay exponentially with the average change of energy. If this happens to be positive, when you change all variables, the change in energy is of order n. So this is exponential of minus something other than 0. Okay, that's why you need to limit yourself to varying only one variable by a small amount. Otherwise, the acceptance probability will be very small. Of course, this procedure brings you a large relaxation times because you have to move many variables in order to have a big global change. You have the problem of criticals going down near the critical region and so on. This can be and has been improved, and you can make large proposals in phase space. You can make that the proposal is actually very different from the actual values. You can make the change from X to Y very different, but you have to be very careful on that. And you cannot do it blind. You have to have a direction for the proposal. A direction for the proposal has been done in two ways, and I will also use that in when I explain this weighted ensemble Monte Carlo. One is the hybrid Monte Carlo, which you use Hamilton's equations to move in phase space, and then you use a metropolis-like acceptance probability in order to accept the new configuration. Or you can use this cluster update algorithms, which run under the name of Swensen Wang, Wolf, Nittermeyer, and so on. What you do is to prepare carefully the new configuration and then accept the change with probability equals to 1. So in order to make blind changes, you have to be very careful how you choose your proposal and your acceptance. Sometimes you really don't care about the whole PDF of X. You just want to compute, for instance, something related to the energy. So you just care about functions of the Hamiltonian. So in this case, you do not need to compute the full distribution P of X, but you can limit yourself to the P of E, the probability distribution for the energy. This is equal to the Boltzmann-Gibbs factor times the number, or density, in a continuous state, of a state with energy E. And then you say, well, how does it look like? Well, this also looks like this, has a peak, which I did not plot to scale. In most large dimensional systems, this peak will be extremely high and very narrow. And then the tails of the distribution are very difficult to think, because they are very, very, very small. When you plot this, omega to the minus beta A for the most typical cases, this decays very, 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 very quickly. So the tails, the probability outside deviation, let's say 2-3 standard deviations from the mean, are basically zero. And you never get the tails of distribution. So by making metropolis or any other something method, what you obtain is this probability distribution only around the maximum, which is a pity. Because if you could get the tails of the distribution, you have an opportunity to get the tails of the distribution, you could use this wonderful trick, which was rediscovered by Fernberg and Sunsing, which is called this extrapolation scheme. It tells you basically that you can compute the average of any function at the temperature T prime by performing the average of other functions at the temperature T, which is when you look at it for the first time, you think it's a wonderful trick. So you only need one simulation at one value of the parameters to obtain the whole variation with temperature of your magnitude of interest, which is fantastic. It's fantastic, but it doesn't work. It doesn't work because this is true, but the configuration's continuity to this average are located at a different maximum than the cooperation continuity to this average, to average of T. Okay, so this is dominated by the tails of the configuration you found at temperature T. The formula is exact and true, but this is dominated by events which will never appear when you sample the temperature T. Okay. Anyway, Fermer and Swenson, well, their contribution was to a study. Of course, when you are near the typical region, this the root mean square of distribution is larger. You have the increase of the fluctuations, and this is the regime of validity is larger. And they made that. They show how to make that a useful tool to analyze systems near the critical region. Another approach is to not to focus on the distribution of states, but compute directly the number of states. That means to compute the entropy. The methods I told you before give you averages, but they do not give you the entropy. Okay? So one idea is to compute directly the entropy or the number of states, the density of states. Of course, when you have that, you can also compute free energies and other things. So I would like to mention that one of the earlier methods, which was developed a number of years ago, this et al. Includes me. I wanted to mention this method. We didn't have a name at the time, but now we call it the HAL, which is the histogram of overlapping windows. And it uses the idea of a restricted walker, idea which has been used in other cases. So it means when you have the true values of the energy that goes from a minimum value to a maximum value, or you cut off from a minimum to a maximum value, you divide that into regions which have one value in common, so the value, the border value belongs to both regions, and then you do restricted simulations only within one of these regions. So make that the one with the phase space. So region number one will correspond to all these values, number two to all these values, number three to all these values, and so on. So what we do is the random movements in this space. Your proposal is random, but then you leave the region you're interested in, you discard the proposal. So you only move within one region. Within one region, you make a histogram. Then the histogram is good, a very, very accurate, because you can make if the number of values is small, you can make a very accurate histogram for all the values within one region. Since there is a common value in the region, by extrapolating, you can actually get a very precise histogram from beginning to end. That's a value of obtaining the density of states, that means the entropy, that means the probability for any value of the energy. And that was actually used then to compute the partition function and to analyze the zeros of the partition function and to determine the critical function. Another approach was called the multi-canonical methods. Multi-canonical methods, the idea is to sample not this function, but to sample another function, a more general weight function. So instead of sampling this, you introduce a PDF, which might have no physical relevance, because this is the exponential of another function, which is a function of the Hamiltonian. This is not the Hamiltonian itself. Okay, it's a function of the Hamiltonian. And then you sample this using, for instance, the choppers. So you propose a change, and you accept that change with a probability which is equal to the minimum between 1 into the minus into the minus the change in omega, and so on. When you do that, you create a histogram. This histogram approximates this distribution for the energy. So the histogram, the value that you obtain, approximate the density of states times e to the minus omega. From there, you think that the entropy can be estimated as the order of this, as this is an arbitrary constant related to the C, plus omega e plus log. So you can determine, using this relation, you can determine the entropy by using an adequate function omega of e. Now, which is the most efficient function to use? The most efficient is the entropy. Use the entropy, then this equals to this, and this is flat. You have a flat histogram. That's what sometimes is called a flat histogram method. A method in which you sample into the minus the entropy. Of course, this is nonsense, because what you want to find is the entropy. You cannot sample into the minus the entropy if what you want to find is the entropy. So what you do is to use a series of approximations to determine the best function omega phi. And there are two schemes that have been used. One is this scheme of Berg, in which the orbital of the beginning is simply to set omega phi equals to zero. Then sample with a constant probability. Of course, we will not sample the whole space, which is a small region, but in the region that you have sampled, you update your omega 1. So use the formula, as I told you before, which is exact if you have a good value for the histogram. Of course, you do not have a good value for the histogram. Some places never appear. So what you do is to define a new function, omega 1, equals to this function, if the value was visited, or zero otherwise. So you, by this, then you repeat that several times. So by this recursion, you actually end up with a flat histogram for this omega function, and you get a good approximation for the image. Another method that was developed more recently is that one or one bar. It was what they do is first they set a constant value for omega, but then what they do is every time a value of energy is visited, you increase the function omega by some amount, which begins to be 1 and so on. Since the probability of acceptance is 2 minus omega, those values which have been visited have a smaller probability of being revisited, because you have increased the value of omega. So the values already visited immediately decrease the probability of being accepted. So what you do is to increase that, then you do a number of times, then the next step, you increase a little bit less, and less, and less, until what you increase is nothing, and you get the good convergence to the true entropy. When you have the good entropy, that's fantastic, because then you can use something similar to the Ferrer-Bergson trick, is to compute the average of any temperature using, those are two lines, very easy to prove. This is this average with respect to this generalized distribution. Okay? So if you get an estimate of a good estimate for the function omega e, then you will do your microcanonic, your generalized simulation using this approximation to the entropy, and you can compute the average at any temperature, which is of course a big advantage to get that. Of course, previous to that, you need to determine this process. But at the end, this is very, very efficient for the numerical content. Now, this is what happens when you do know the stationary distribution, which is e to the minus beta e, or the distribution can be adapted. So I'm interested here in problems in which we do not know the stationary distribution. Okay. We do not have an expression for it. And for instance, think about problems of this case. Think about the stochastic differential equations with white noise. I'm particularly interested in those. I will be showing examples with this particular structure, this diagonal noise. I want to compute the stationary distribution, numerical stationary distribution, and the current, which appears in this. So this is a fraction of a more general problem, which you have a more general noise terms, and all of you have been exposed to that one time or another, is that you can find right focal point equation for this. Focal point equation meets the form of a continuity equation with some current. This is special for the current. And then what I wanted to stress here is that in some particular cases, when the coefficients of the deterministic and the stochastic term satisfy some fluctuation, distribution relation, in this case, you know stationary distribution. And then you could apply what I told you before. But what happens when there is no closed expression for the stationary distribution? What happens when these conditions are not satisfied, and we do not know which is the stationary distribution corresponding to this stochastic dependent. So how to sample this starting, how to sample stochastic distribution starting for the stochastic equation. Now, the method is not that general as we would like to be. Okay, it's suitable for a small number of variables. And for the moment being, I will consider only just one variable. Yeah? For one variable, we can always find the stochastic distribution, as you know. But still, I would like to, for the sake of clarity, to use this, at least this N1 notation. Now, what is the idea? The idea is, first, of course, I'm going to use a numerical method, so I want to discretize a space. I will not compute the probability distribution for every value of x. I will discretize a space. So I will set a minimum and a maximum value, and discretize the space with some space in delta x. Okay? This is what we call the prime mesh. And then we focus not on the whole values, P of X, but the values only at those selected points. So P of I of T is a property of B in that subregion recall. And eventually, in order, this subregion might be small, the method would require this to be small, but it might not be interested in such a fineness. So I want to be interested in the property at some selected point. Let's just make this not. So this is the space of X. I make the fine mesh. This is delta X for the fine mesh. Then I might be at the end, because that might be a true fine mesh. Just to be interested in the property distribution in such a large region. So I define P of I of T is the integral over one subregion. These are the big points, and then the property of the big points simply add the properties at the inside point and divide by delta X to have a proper bit. There's just some detail to fix notation. What I want to say is that I will focus on this vector of probabilities, which are the probabilities at each one of these fine mesh. One idea I've been using is called the Brownian dynamics. So simply take one particle, I let it evolve according to those equations. There are good integrators, that was, you know, the Euler, the Horn, the Einstein, whatever. You integrate the stochastic differential equations, and then you generate a trajectory. And then from that, you come from this trajectory, simply estimate the PDF. Simply see which places have been visited more often, and you have this, after some transient times, of course you have a distribution of the PDF. But this is a poor approximation. It suffers the same problem as before. There are regions which have a very low probability that will never revisit. They will never revisit in your lifetime. They will revisit eventually. You run the simulation for a very, very long time. But in general, those regions we operate will never be revisited. So you have pretty concentrated in regions. And you do not sample the tails. What you want to do, what we want to do, is to sample the tails of distribution. So the idea is the following. We introduce we have taken this idea of weighted walkers. So the walkers here simply walk blindly. They simply walk according to the equations, but they do nothing else. It is the following. We did, after dividing this integration, we set an initial value for the probability. Usually this is a constant, unless we have some previous knowledge. We have some previous knowledge of how the distribution should look like, so you could use the initial condition using your approximation, your information. But in general, simply use a uniform distribution for the initial state. Then, in each of these subregions, remember the small delta x, I put n walkers, n independent walkers. These walkers are distributed uniformly and independently. Okay, this is really one of the novelties of the method compared to ours. So we put n independent walkers. Then we define the position of walker k in region I. So they will have n regions, and in each one of them we put n walkers. Okay, then imagine here the in one of the tiles we put 3, 4, 5 walkers. Then these walkers start to move according to the Brownian dynamics. So their positions evolve according to the differential equations. The novelty is that these walkers carry a weight. So they are not equal. They move according to this, but each one carries a weight. A weight is a fraction of the probability of the region in which they are. So you start with a region. In this region, there's a probability of P L of T, and this is divided between the n walkers. So there are three walkers, one of them carries 1/3 of the probability of that particular region. And then they start to move. Okay? They evolve in time by using the integrator of the stochastic differential equation, whatever you want to use. This is, if this is the landscape, I will recognize it. Mm-hmm. We have here the walkers. You see the walkers are moving around using the, they're independent. Okay? In each one of the regions, we set a number of walkers, and then they move independently one of the others. But they carry the probability. They have a backpack. In this backpack, they carry the probability from one region to the other. So, after time state H, when they have reached a new region, this probability is given to the subregion. So we update the values of the probability at that subregion by simply adding up all the weights of the walkers, which are at that moment at that region. Okay? After this, we start again. These are the three basic steps. Let me repeat it. Distribute n walkers. Give to each one of them share the probability of that region. Evolve. Give that probability to the new region. Okay? So the new time t plus h, the weight of the carrier, the weight that the worker carries will be again a fraction, a uniform fraction of the probability of that region. We call a running step these three steps: redistribution, integration, and updating probabilities. So we repeat these running steps many times. Of course, there are the typical issues. You need to equilibrate the system. You need to wait for a time before the stationary state has been reached. Then when this happens, these probabilities will fluctuate around the mean values. Then once you are in the steady state, you need to average about so many steps, and then you need to avoid high correlation, you need to let some number of running steps between two measurements. But this is the usual stuff. So what you need to, the algorithm really, what you need to tune is the number of workers, the time state age and size of subregion, this is for conversion of the algorithm, make sure that you have equilibrated, and then other parameters simply improve the statistics. So here we have only three parameters, which are n, h, and delta h. These are the usual parameters which will appear in any sampling. I remember that I will show you results about the stationary PDF compute. That also improves the statistics. Okay? I will not show you the fine mesh, but it will average about a number of fine points. There are technical details, we need some boundary conditions, have value at another value, I use reflective boundary conditions and so on. I will also be interested in computing the current. So the current is the flow of probability. So in order to compute that, we use the following. I position myself in one of the borders of the regions, then I count the probability that carry the workers that walk to the right, minus the probability that the workers that carry that go to the left. How do I know that worker has gone to the right or the left? Simply I know that position t was greater than xi, and at previous time was small, and this moves to the right. On the other hand, both are where time t minus h, a position larger than x, and then they cross at time t here, it means that they move to the left. So simply by focusing here, I count how many go to the right, how many go to the left, and add what they carry in the backpacks. Let me show you the result, okay? You can write a master equation for this and show that it will be the result of this process is the stationary distribution and so on. I don't want to show you that. I just want you the results, which I think is more interesting about this technique, is the amazing result that you can get. So I use a typical example, okay? This is the bistable potential. Nothing fancy about this. Bistable potential, we know the stationary distribution. And we use a small value for this noise term. Okay? This is really a small value. Those of you who have done this is a small value. So small that when you compute the probability at the top or the bottom, you can see that there's a fraction of a ratio of 10 to the 11. Okay, so these values are really very, very unlikely to happen. So you simply use random workers and move them around, you will never reach this. You will need a time 10 to the 11 to reach this, which will never happen, okay, in your lifetime. So sampling this by workers will never be, even by Monte Carlo. Even Monte Carlo, those values have such a small probability that will never be accepted. Never be accepted. So it's very difficult to sample this region, of course, the Kelsen distribution. Let me tell you, anything else here? No. That's all I want to check. So let me show you first the equilibration in the state. So we set the minimum value to minus 2.5 and 2.5. With time step to the minus 4, delta x 20 to the minus 4, 46,000 points in the mesh. These are technical details. And then, yes, how many workers we need to reach a good convergence. Very surprising that the number of workers only determines the time it takes you to reach the steady state. And you can do that, workers are independent. In fact, no surprise. Okay? Workers are simply independent. But you can study how long does it take you to reach the steady state as a function of the number of workers. Of course, the more workers you have, the more work you have to do. And the more steps you need to, the more variables you need to integrate. So here we put the PDF of the point zero, that was 10 to the minus 11, remember? So I study how this probability varies as a function of time. time is measured number of the units of the equation. So you can see that when you have less walkers, you have only two walkers, you still reach the steady state. You reach in a longer time. So we decided simply to take two walkers per region and to thermalize up to time equals to 50. Okay? We could use 16 and thermalize up to 20, but it doesn't pay off. Okay? Because the more walkers you have, then the more work you need to do. So we take two walkers, thermalize up to 50, and then this process an average. This is what we want to get. So we're still showing the results, in a log scale. And this is the log of this distribution. This is double peak and minus 1 and plus 1. The tails are very unlikely. We will go to minus 2. This is minus 11, 10 to the minus 11. If we go to the tails, you know, you can reach up to 10 to the minus 300. Remember, the noise is 0.001. It's 10 to the minus 2. It's very small noise. So the tails are very, very, very rare. And then if you notice here, we have the analytical result plus the simulation results. So in this method, we have managed to compute probabilities of 10 to the minus 300, which I could not believe the first time I saw. Okay, by this distribution technique, you can really, really, really sample very small probabilities. And this is actually the main message. So if you need to sample distributions which you care about the tails very unlikely, you might consider using something like this. This is the blue lines. There are two lines, okay? There's the continuous and the algorithm, which are almost on top of each other. There is a blow up here for blow up of distribution, only up to the 0, 10 to the minus 10. So it's just blowing up this region. Again, there's a very nice convergence between the algorithm and the exact result. The blue line is a result of just setting Brownian walkers. Okay? Simply walk the walk around, but do not care about probability. Simply they move around, and then you compute how long they spend in each of the regions, and then you compute that with you. Here, this is different running times. Okay, you run up to one time. I forgot exactly what the details, but this is for different running times. At the most, you can get there with this 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 7. But you can never reach those values, those small values. Not just that, we can also compute the current, pretty current that goes from one point to the other. You know, it's very unlikely for this low value of the noise to jump from one world to the other. Very, very unlikely. It will take you forever to jump to one. The flux is very low. So what we do to study this flux, we set the initial condition at one. So we set all the walkers initially there at one. And we put here, so this is the condition we say. So initially, the probability is focused only at one. There's a nice thing about this also is that since walkers which do not carry probability do not contribute, you only need to put at the beginning walkers at this particular point. You do not need to integrate walkers in those regions we have initially zero probability, which also is a big improvement of our other methods. So we just put two walkers at n equals to 1, those walkers move around, then you put it to the other sides, and so on. And then we establish a absorbing boundary, not at 0, to be to the left of 0. Okay? Look at the crossing, not of 0, but the crossing of these values. So one walker, when it reaches that point, is reinjected there. This is where we simulate the flux of particles through zero. And then we measure, by the formula I gave you before, this current through this point, not through zero, but through minus 0.01. Okay. Again, there is some convergence that you need. So you measure this current as a function of the time for different values of the noise intensity, 0.1 to 4 times to the minus 4. You can see the initial decreases exponentially, and then it saturates to a value. So we put those values as a function of the noise intensity, and we know the theoretical result, which is Arrhenius' law. See that this current should scale as the exponential of the barrier divided by the noise intensity. And you can see effectively that this is well confirmed, this Arrhenius' law. But which is most amazing is that this goes down to 10 to the minus 296. Okay, so these values are really to trust. This is a theoretical Arrhenius prediction for this one, and this is the result. You can go to values of noise very, very small, take you 10 to the minus 4 and maybe smaller. Well, this is a case in which how long did it take?
Why?
How long?
Why do you have small error bars for?
Might have to do with the log scale. Log scale always has errors. The students know that very well. show something in log scale and then.
No, but it works in the other way. The other way around. No.
Yep. It has to be log scale. Okay, so this is it. Okay. So this is it. It's an algorithm which is very, I think, easy to implement, which allows you to compute for a set of stochastic differential equations which you do not know. Even if you do know, the probability distribution allows you to compute the tails of distribution, also the current between the different states. Here it comes a technical detail of how to choose the time step and the size step. Of course, the time step H has to be chosen, of course, in order to convert for your numerical method, for the coin or the music method, needs to convert to a small time step. But usually, the ones we use are very small. So this is no problem with the convergence of the method. An important issue is that the workers are independent of each other. Okay? So another thing you can, this simulation was run in one PC, and running for 24 hours. Okay? Wanted really to show good results, so we had this thing running for a long time. It was one PC, okay? To be only simulation one PC. Of course, you can run in parallel and longer or shorter, whatever. Some of the other results that I will show you do not have such a high precision for two reasons. One of them is because they are two-dimensional systems, and second, because we did not run that long. So we ran just for a few minutes, and we got the results with a few minutes. But this has been obtained with 24 hours of running. Okay. Now, it's how you set the delta x, the size of the region, is that, of course, when you got the redistribution, is the workers are relocated at the different subregions. But they are located uniformly. So you have, as initial state, a uniform distribution within each subregion, which is not right. Distribution is not uniform within subregion. So what you need to do is that the dynamics is enough to wash out the memory of this initial condition. So what you need to do is that this diffusion length, when you move due to the stochastic terms, is larger than your bin size. And this gives you a criterion to determine the size of the region, which has to be smaller than this in this quantity. Of course, when the nexus is small, the region has to be smaller. Now, in order for the method to be able to sample regions with a large variation of the potential, if the deterministic term is large, is immediately washed away from that area. In order for the method not to get a good agreement also at the point at which the potential is large, the variation of the potential is large, you also need that the variation due to the deterministic terms are smaller than the variation due to the stochastic terms. So they give you some criteria that you need to satisfy in order for the method to. So there's some fine tuning of the parameters that you need to do. So it took me 24 hours plus several days to tune the parameters of the right numbers. All I want to do now is to show you two more examples, okay? I'm finished, I'll tell you what I want to tell you. I'll give you two more examples. This example, I used that because I think it was very much used in Humboldt University, this Poincaré oscillator. It actually belongs to a general family of oscillator, which have a Hamiltonian structure plus an extra term. But the extra term is such that it's zero at the Hamiltonian orbit. Okay? So what you do is you converge to the Hamiltonian orbit. For instance, that particular example, the Hamiltonian is 1/2 of x squared plus y squared. And now the nice thing about this is that you can compute the stationary distribution. Okay, so I'll get another example. It's a bidimensional system which you can compute. There's only noise in one direction. That gives some technical problems related to the size of the time steps and the size of the regions and so on. But you can actually compute the stationary distribution, and it looks like this. As a maximum, at this in Hamiltonian equals to 1. Okay, so the idea is the same. Simply divide that in regions, subregions, square subregions, then let the workers walk away, and redistribute the probability, and here we have show a control plot of the PDF. Okay, these are different values, 0.1, 0.01, and so on. And you can see the theoretical result, which is the circles, and which is, you know, this is symmetric with respect to x squared plus y squared. this is x and y, and this is the analytical, this is the numerical result. Because the numerical result is quite good, up to 10 to the minus 12. Here there is some discrepancy in the deterministic direction, actually. But still, it's quite good with just a few minutes, okay, of calculation. That took about 20 minutes of calculation to do the, compare the PDF up to a value 10 to the minus 10, let's say, accuracy. So very good agreement up to this, just a few minutes of calculation. There's another example, which also interests.
Do you have probability, non-vanishing probability coverage?
Here, yeah, because you have a particle buffer around here. There's a current in the in here. So you will have a current. I think I think it's just when you have this, when the Hamiltonian dynamics, when you have this rotating there, when you have noise, you still have this rotating over there. So you have a flux of particles interaction, which I didn't compute. You don't believe it?
Let's try it.
Now we take another system which is of interest in the Humble group, which is this bistable system with colors. But in this case, it's an example which we do not know the statistical distribution, but there are many approximations, and you ask Maximo Pera how to use that with color noise, how to use the protein distribution, but there is no exact theory to determine that. But we don't care here. So we simply take the stochastic equation of movement. One of them is deterministic, the other is stochastic. This is the color noise. And integrate that with our methods, divide that into x, y regions, and well, these are. A result here is that the theory predicts that beside the two maxima at the maxima of the local potential and zero noise, and so the noise is symmetric, there are also another values of the time correlation and the noise intensity for which a maximum appears, and this appears to be true. This is the XY distribution. This is for a small value of the correlation time. For large value of the correlation time, you can see that there appears there another maximum or distribution. Okay, here we have not actually compared that way. But this is not an intentional thing to compare that with some theoretical results and so on. But you can see again the nice determination of the probability. You can see that to 10 to the minus 12, 10 to the minus 8, you get a nice determination of the contour levels for this problem. Whereas if you use simply the Brownian dynamics, you get a much, these are the red or workers which do not carry probability among regions. And the black, this technique of current probability among the different regions. And you can see that this is giving you much worse statistics. And you can go to match this 10 to the minus 6 versus 10 to the minus 12. So you can sample in much worse details of this division. That's the final example and finish. It's this figure of Raúl that we have used here in many, many cases. There are, well, this in some cases that meets a potential distribution, so in some cases you have a non-distortion distribution, some cases you do not. I just want again to show some results in which you can see the control levels, how can they compute. Of course, you can also compute the current here, which we have not done. So these are, you know, these are models have been used to study neural the potential neurons, and what might be of interest to use that technique to establish the current between the current that's established here. It's an this is in the excitable regime, so this actually fixed one here, when it's passed, it goes around, you can compute the current or something. Well, we have not done this. So this is it. So I just give you first a review of how to sample the tails of a distribution when you know the expression for a distribution. Then I'm going to use a class of weighted ensemble Brownian dynamics to sample a PDF when you have stochastic differential equations, whether you know stochastic distribution or not, doesn't matter. The idea is to do workers that are distributed uniformly or independently at lattice points, but then they carry probability between the regions. Okay, by these having probabilities, they can manage to sample the phase space. But yet, in every step, in every region, you put workers everywhere. So eventually, these workers will take the probability So the quantity will be distributed everywhere. Okay, this is the idea of the method. We can show that this method can sample extremely well the tails of the PDF in simple low-dimensional cases. You can reach very small points, up to 10 to the minus 300, which I think is remarkable. If you need it, it's good, but you don't need it, it's good. Now, the method is in principle valid for any high-dimensional distribution, but of course, it enters that the number of subregions grows exponentially with the dimension of the system. So, this is still a challenge to generalize that to spatial large dimensionality. There are problems. It seems that in some cases you can go to high dimension and then group the regions into given regions. So we're still trying to generalize that to other cases. And that's all. Thank you.
Questions, comments, remarks?
So this, you are looking at so high precision, you will fit, you will see any defect on the random number generator. But you, the answer is still very good.
Well, you know, our random generator is very good.
So it's still, I mean, the division, the one.
I don't know, there are some discrepancies here, which I don't know what it would do with poor statistics or and here there were.
Because you know that any.
But I don't think this is.
There are examples of checking the quality of random number generators by comparing careful simulations with extra results. And okay, probably this is a.
Well, I don't see this is a.
Some very.
This is a very stringent test. Well, you can see there's no difference there, too.
Why no example with negative noise?
It
was.
It can be used as well. Oh, there is no limitation to the.
And no problem with the discretization of into stochastic mapping?
Well, you need a discretization rule. Yeah. Your stochastic differential equation has to be defined in some sense. So this is it. You simply use the integrator that suits interpretation of your equation.
You are sampling here stationary distributions. Now, and you go to very high precision. Now, these points with very low probability would also affect when you numerically do some of the calculations. For instance, imagine that you do a calculation of a correlation function, mm-hmm. and you do a normal simulation, and then there are points in which you would not have very good precision. Is there a way to adapt what you are doing here to calculate these other things like correlation functions or other statistical properties with high precision?
He's not with a one-time probability because the Gaussian need a two-time.
Well, that's what I'm asking. He's sampling the stationary one-time.
Stationary one-time. And you need stationary two-times. At least for a stationary correlation.
So you have the same state?
Steady state time dependent correlation
function. I think you are in the steady state. Right.
But you are resampling, so you are redistributing the workers on
the but the probability is remains in the region. It remains in the region.
My question is very naive. I mean, you give me one of these stochastic differential equations, I could do a simple simulation and calculate a stationary distribution. It would not have the precision you have at some points. Now,
you know how
to solve that. Now, if I go to correlation functions, at some point, my precision is bad because I'm not sampling properly these things. Now, the question is, can you extend that to calculation of and other statistical properties, or even time-dependent statistical properties.
Time-dependent, not because you need a stationary here.
You need a stationary distribution, but I don't know. I think, my guess is that in the stationary distribution, in the stationary state, you could compute the correlations. I'm not too sure how to do it. You said the weapon is distributed, but the probability is not. It remains. So their weight, what remains in the set is the weight. So the weapon is just auxiliary.
For the two-dimensional correlation function, you need some probability distribution condition to start with one point. So not to the state, not the state, but But starting in a given point,
you could calculate the correlation starting on a given point, look at where you go, calculate the correlation for that, then redistributing again and proceeding in a sort of step by step. So you take into account where you go, depending on where you start, and you calculate the correlation for that time. Of course, you will only be able to calculate correlations with effect in a finite amount of time, but probably you can adapt that. By doing a sort of a step, procedure, and then redistributing everything.
No more questions?
Okay. Necesito.